Hi, this is Lane at Liberty. Today at my Safe at Home lab, I want to talk about fracture growth through laminations. Now, frackers create value by breaking stuff. Breaking rock and hydraulic fracturing provides almost 60% of all primary energy used by Americans. How a material breaks is driven by the strength and the cohesiveness of that material. We call this toughness. And I've discussed this in the past in experiments on fracture initiation in bananas and paper in other videos. But rock is a more complex material. And also, miles underground, rock is under great stress. Another complication of rock is that its properties depend on the orientation, for example, through laminations that originate from the depositional environment when the rock was made. Rock is laminated. You can see here, cardboard has laminations in it to provide it extra strength. Fracture growth behavior is very different if the fractures grow along these laminations or if they grow perpendicular to these laminations. Let me show you. So the fracture growth is nicely along the laminations. And with another example I have, where the laminations are perpendicular to the initial cut I made, fracture growth will be slightly different. And it's also quite a bit tougher to break the material. It takes me quite a bit of effort to break it, and you can see it actually breaks along a different orientation. Much, much tougher to break material when you're going through the laminations instead of along them.
Trees have layered rings of wood associated with yearly growth. Wood's resistance against pulling or tension is very different perpendicular to laminations as opposed to parallel to laminations. When we put this wood slab on its side, you could imagine a similar cross-section extended into horizontal rock layering.
This pulling test is a compact tension specimen, which is a common test to measure toughness of a material. Now, the initial pre-cut here is about 4 inches, and the pulling holes and this pre-cut are all scaled by the size of the specimen itself. In this case, 12 inches by about 12 inches. And the wood sample here, the spine is about 3/4 of an inch thick, but you can also do it on samples that are 1/4 or maybe 1/2 inch thick. Now we're pulling outward from the holes and measure the pulling force. So I'm measuring the force multiplier from this little piece all the way to the end of the 10 footer to determine how I should multiply the force applied to this little specimen. And then I can pull from the, pull up from the other side by measuring how much my weight increases on a scale. So let me show you how that works in this particular example. All right.
Our first test is medium density fiber board, or MDF. Fractures grow straight and perpendicular to the orientation of tension, like they would when the state of stress controls fracture orientation. The material is relatively strong, but there are no laminations to change fracture growth. The second test is plywood. This material has 3 layers, thin outer layers with laminations going from top to bottom, and thicker internal laminations that go from left to right. As we see, the frack wants to grow along the dominant internal laminations, but outer laminations make this fracture growth a little harder. The next series of tests is in pine. This material more closely represents our geological analogy, and this is what I really want to show here. In the first 2 tests with laminations along the pre-cut, the material is weak or a low toughness, and the fracture easily follows the laminations. In the next 2 tests with laminations perpendicular to the pre-cut, the fracture wants to follow the weakness of the laminations, even though the direction of tension is very different. Note that it took 3-4 times the pulling force to open fractures along this orientation. I added oriented strand board as one final example. This was by far the strongest material, as fibers are randomly oriented. Fractures will not follow the preferential orientation like an MDF. The randomly oriented particles act like pieces of rock and cement, creating concrete that is much, much tougher to break than cement. At several miles depth, growing from a horizontal well into rock, hydraulic fractures also grow slower when growing through laminations. This is why hydraulic fractures are significantly longer than they are tall. In rock, the preference for hydraulic fracture growth along laminations is balanced by the 3D state of stress, which generally favors vertical growth through layers. As these two growth mechanisms find a balance, hydraulic fractures may alternate between vertical and horizontal growth. Microseismic data, represented by the orange dots, shows a fracture geometry that is at least 5 times longer than it is tall. The fracture model backdrop has been calibrated with this geometry and net pressure data to provide a more reliable fracture design tool.
In conclusion, the shape of a hydraulic fracture depends on many parameters, including the state of stress and how laminations are oriented versus depth fracture growth. At Liberty, we use calibrated models to help determine the best levers for design optimization and dollar per BO minimization. For more information, visit us at libertyfrac.com. This is Lane at Liberty. Thank you for watching.